So the evolution of a completely positive semigroup, its generator has this form. Now let's elaborate. This is a Hamiltonian part. This is a unitary part of the evolution. Now this is called the non-unitary or dissipative part of the evolution. And what does it contain? You see, it contains something that would look like Krauss form, the sandwich, like here, but with different operators, V, rho, V dagger. So I have the sandwich here, but I have another piece here that you can say balances this and makes it completely positive. You could say, once I know this is this part that has to be here because I need something that will look like Krauss, this is how Lindblad gets the other part. Is to say, since I want it to be Krauss, I have to have this to make it completely positive. So you could say it's a mathematical construction, but he gets a form that looks like that. And now we should remember the assumptions. Assumptions that at every instant it's Krauss form, which also says, and that's what people forget, that at every instant my system and Bethe are tensor product. Which, when we'll reach to Davis, this is a very delicate point, because if my system and Bethe are uncorrelated, you would think nothing should happen. Because if you want to transfer energy between the system and Bethe, you have to generate correlation. So, but on the other hand, once I assume this form, I say there are tensor product at every instant. So thermodynamically, this is, makes sense, because you can say my system is influenced by the environment, but it's still a system. And one way to think about it, it's kind of a thermodynamic limit, that the energy that's included in the interface is very small related to everything else. So most of the properties are bulk properties, and the properties of the interface can be, to some approximation, thrown away. We'll see this is equivalent to second order Born approximation. So, can you can say, yeah.
Does that Hamiltonian H in that Lindblad equation include the interaction term in the...
So this, that's why I put this, it's not the free Hamiltonian of the system. You can say it's modified by the Bethe. So this is not the free Hamiltonian. Then you'll see there's another caveat about that. That I'll reach to that, that this definition is not unique, which makes it even more difficult. The whole thing is unique. But here I said this is my unitary part and this is my dissipative part. So you can say, can I move part of it into here? The answer is yes. And if you asked, I'll just have, for this I have to look at my notes, because it's a good, the invariance on Lindblad. If I, you can say here I have operators V. So if I change my operator and I say V prime is equal to V and I add to it an identity. If I do that, it doesn't change this, but it changes what is H and what is V. Now you just put stick it in and you'll see you'll get a modified Hamiltonian part. Okay. This is, I would say, also something that people are not aware of, that Lindblad form by itself is unique, but the partition to unitary and dissipative is not unique. So if you want to say this is a unitary part and this is a dissipative part, you really can't say that. If it's not unique, You have to look at it as a whole. So, if you do this operation, the lintel becomes invariant to this transformation. So then the Hamiltonian, okay, do this exercise and you can figure this out. Okay, so now this looks very abstract at this point, and without examples, I would say this is useless. So let's take some simple examples of lintel. So write it up here, because otherwise you can see. So I say, okay, so before I do that, I can take this, and since we said that what we care about is A times O, so I can do, this is Schrödinger's form, I'll go to Heisenberg. So L star operating on an operator A would be plus I divided by H bar, unitary is like that, and plus J, and now I have to move the daggers. V dagger A V minus a half V dagger V A plus A V dagger. So this is Heisenberg's form. And let's look at this. The first operator to put here is identity. To see what's, because this tells you A dot. So what's the change in time in the identity? Zero, because this means that probabilities should be conserved. So this should be zero by definition. So we can check this. If we stick in for the operator A, the identity, we should get zero. The identity doesn't change in time. So identity commutes with everything, so this part is zero. If I put here the identity, this becomes V dagger V. And here again I get here 2 times V dagger V with a minus sign, and I get zero. So you can say this property of conservation of probability works for this form of Lindblad equation of motion. So this is okay. So we understand what happens to the identity. Okay, now let's take a few important examples which Lindblad himself noticed already. He wrote them in his paper, but for Lindblad, since most of it is mathematics, it's 3 lines in his paper. What are the examples? So the first example is, let's take V to be Hermitian. So I have an abstract form. I can do this because nothing, any operator in my system is good from the point of view of Lindblad. But then we should interpret, what does it mean if V is Hermitian here? Which type of evolution do we get if V is Hermitian? So now I'm going back from mathematics to physics. I have a mathematical form that you got through this procedure of completely positive and group structure, all kinds of abstract things that we want, but now we connect to physics. So what happens here? Then L of A becomes the unitary part, doesn't change, but this becomes double commutator Wisby. Okay, this is some algebra to work the commutators to get this form. You check me, do it yourself, otherwise you won't be convinced. But this is what you get, double commutator with AV. Now, why was Lindblad happy? Because this form of a semigroup was already derived before. This type of double commutator was known. So he was happy that he got to something that somebody else found before him. And this, the name of this is a Gaussian semigroup. So all forms of Gaussian semigroup have this. I'll show you how to derive it in a different way. And this result was known by Kusakovsky. Gurin and Kusakovsky have a paper that they derive directly this equation from a time-dependent Hamiltonian, which has this one Hamiltonian here, plus V times F of T, where, so this is my Hamiltonian, and F of T is stochastic. The average is zero, and if I wrote it like that, is delta t minus t prime. So physically, what does it mean? This is mathematics, right? I have a system evolution, which it has a system without anybody bothering it, plus gets random kicks from the environment. Now, these random kicks are defined by this function. So the average of this function is zero. So I get positive and negative kicks equally. But their correlation is delta correlated. So once in a while, I kick my, the environment kicks my system. So there are many situations that go like that. And why is it Gaussian? Because the assumption these kicks are independent. So if I have independent, many independent accumulated kicks, I get the Gaussian process from the central limit theory. So you can say this is a very simple model of a system as free evolution plus an evolution that's influenced by the environment, but it's only one-sided. The environment kicks it randomly, but the environment doesn't care. It kicks if it hits something or not. The environment doesn't care. This is the assumption here. So it's one-sided. It's only the environment influences the system. There is no back action in this type of evolution. So if you take this, you derive the generator, you average over this Gaussian noise. It's quite a simple exercise to do. You get this semigroup. So this semigroup describes in general the influence of random noise on a quantum process. And the assumption that the noise doesn't care is independent of the system. There's no back action. Yeah.
In the Heisenberg form, there shouldn't be explicit time dependence of the operator.
This is Heisenberg, yeah.
The upper equation. The equation checking one.
This?
So there should be time, explicit time dependence.
Yeah, if A is, I should add that. If you want to, you're right. I can add. Okay, so when else do we get this? Because this form is very general, and you get it in other instances. So when you apply, now I'm telling you something, I won't prove it here, when you apply a weak quantum measurement to my system. So here's my quantum system, and I look at it like that. Peep a little bit. Why do I do that? I don't want to bother it too much. Because if I measure, I collapse my system, I bother it. So I do a weak quantum measurement only on the side of my eye, and then you bother it a little bit. But I do that continuously. So I continuously gather information on my system. So you can say each instance I learn something about my system, and as a measuring apparatus, I can then feedback later or something like that. But then in this case, since I do quantum measurement, you can ask, how is the system influenced by this measurement? So this is what happens. The equation of motion of the system becomes exactly the same equation of motion as random Gaussian mass. So if I'm a system, and somebody is measuring me behind my back, or somebody is kicking me, I don't know the difference. If you use this information to do feedback, then this equation will be modified. But if I just measure the system, I generate this type of Lindblad equation. So we get it for Gaussian noise, and we get it for quantum measurement. So this is, you could say, the advantage of a mathematical form. It describes different types of physics in the same kind of form. Okay. So this was the first example of Lindblad, which he was happy because he related it to a Gaussian semigroup. Now the second equation, the second example, okay, I'll leave it here, I'll get rid of this, was, let's say that V is unitary and S dagger is identity. So as we said, in Lindblad form here, V can be any operator you want. It doesn't be Hermitian, unlike this piece here. So it can be unitary. So what do we get out of that? L on A. Again, I get my Hamiltonian part. Plus J, and here I'll get this, S, A, like that, for example. But this is one, and this is one. So this would be minus A. Now I can multiply it by some parameter outside. Okay, so here if I want, I could put a sum, multiply it here by some number. Let's call it P, lambda G, gamma G. And I get, again, a special example of Lindblad. And again, Lindblad was happy, because this form was known by Schwinger in 1954, was developed for semi. So now, again, we have to go back from mathematics into physics. What does this describe? Which type of evolution is described here? So on purpose, I wrote S here. And this is where Schwinger comes. Schwinger was interested in scattering theory. So S is my scattering matrix. So what is scattering? Scattering is a unitary evolution, which I started particles before, uncorrelated. They collided, and then they went to infinity. And the process is described by an S matrix, which tells me my evolution from beginning to end through a scattering process. So you can say if I have a scattering process, the final is S, or and this is initial. This is, in a nutshell, scattering theory. defined by the S matrix. S matrix is unitary, for again, for the same type of idea. So, what is this? This is Otto Heisenberg, that's why this dagger moved from here to here. This is the state of the operator A after the scattering event. This is the operator A before the scattering event. So this is the difference that operator A went through because of scattering. So this is a change in, let's in this case, the operator A. If I'll write it in Schrödinger form, maybe it will be a little bit easier to think about it like that. It'll be minus. And I'll take one term here. Okay, so let's look here. This is Schrödinger. So this is a state of the system after scattering. This is a state before. This is a change in my system due to scattering. And here my parameter is a scattering rate. And this is how Schrödinger got to this equation. He said, if I have a dilute gas, molecules in this room, once in a while they collide. I want to know how does this gas evolve. So I can say, this is a scattering event. This is a change due to scattering event. And I multiply it by the rate of scattering events, which would be proportional to the density of the gas that we have here in this room. So this is how Schrödinger got to this form. Basically, the way I'm telling you, you guessed it. Now, this is called the Poissonian process because the assumption that the events are independent. Each collision event is independent of another. That's why we say this is a good equation for dilute gas. Once in a while, you collide. I walk, I collide, I walk, I collide, and each collision is independent. So that's why I can put here rate of collisions times change due to collision. So what we see here is another example of a Lindblad equation, which fits to things that people guessed in a different way, that the evolution of a dilute gas is also described by Lindblad form. You can say Schrödinger was much before Lindblad, that you can say the advantage of Lindblad is generalization. So you can say this is one example, this is a Gaussian another example, and these are the examples that you find in Lindblad's paper. Okay, so,
How can we be sure that the transfer from the dilute gas to dense gas? How can I increase the scattering rate that we sure that we are limit of the dilute gas?
Can we increase so this type of equation only works for, because when we built this to this, we need the assumption of a Poissonian assumption that each event is independent from each other. So if it's dilute gas, it's okay. But then you're right that there's like many of these things, where's the problem? When I start to really cool down. Mm-hmm. Now we use this theory to try to derive the third law. Mm-hmm. But then you could say maybe you're doing something wrong, because when you become colder and colder, you're De Broglie wavelength increases, and then this assumption of independent collisions starts to break down. But then, okay, this is where our world becomes fuzzy and where to define. But then you can think about solid state, which is another example. Then we start to think, this would describe collision with quasi-particles. So again, I would use an S matrix to do that. So I can say, if I generate electron hole pair, I can describe it by this formula. Although you can say it's not dilute, but it's dilute from the point of view of quasi-particles. So if my quasi-particles are independent stochastically, I could use the same theory for them. But I think these questions are good because you could say this, we already know that Lindblad is not perfect. It's an idealization. So the question is, can we put our physics into this idealization? It at least gives us some limit that we know that if this idealization is correct, these are the results that we should get. Now, like any ideal, it doesn't work always. We're living in a real world, not in an ideal world. It would be nice. Okay, so now we have this. So let's see where else it's connected to other results that people found. So we have these two results, and I'll leave Lindblad and go to something. Another famous example, and let's say that my Hamiltonian is a harmonic oscillator. So I'm talking now about harmonic oscillator coupled to a bath, and this example was also known independently in the community of quantum optics. They got Lindblad form without knowing it's Lindblad. So you can find this in the book of Lundsted as a guess. But this connection was done later. So now I can write again the same thing. dBt of A, L of A, and we want to write this for the harmonic oscillator. So this will be I omega A dagger A is my operator A from here. And now for V, I'll choose the operator A. Why not? So here I'll get A. Okay, if I write it like that, minus A dagger A, A plus A dagger A, A dagger A. So you know what? I wouldn't put a sum. Write these terms explicitly. So we'll call this K1 plus K2, the opposite, which in this case V would be A dagger. This is, we started from Lindblad form, we chose a specific example, our harmonic oscillator, we chose V, we could say V1 is A, V2 is A dagger, and we put it in Lindblad form. What we got is a master equation. Now we could call it a master equation because this is how it's called in quantum optics. We got the master equation for harmonic oscillator coupled to a bath. So it's Lindblad form because we constructed it from Lindblad. We have two operators here, K1 and K down, and we have this equation. Now, one way to do, we go to the book on quantum optics, and we see we can find this equation, and so you can say it makes us happy because we know it's not only mathematics, it has some physical meaning. But then we can say, okay, what does this mean? How can I study this equation and understand what it does. So the way to do that is solve it, because harmonic oscillators, everything is solvable. We just can, let's solve this Heisenberg equations of motion and see what happens if we put explicit operators into this equation. So what do we have to do? For example, we can ask, what's the change in time of the operator A, which tells us about the coherence in the system. So we know, if I stick it here, it would be I omega. The commutator of A with A dagger is minus 1. So I'll get your minus A for my first term here. And then I'll write this, and I'll show you how to do this easily, hopefully. So instead of A, I write A minus half A dagger A plus A dagger A close. Let's take one term. The other one goes the same way. So now I need to evaluate what's written here. But let's see, I have here A dagger AA, and here I have A dagger AA. So I can get rid of this term and put here a half. Now I have A dagger AA and A dagger AA. So what do I have to do? I can, for example, switch. Use this identity that the commutator of A and A dagger, which is A dagger minus A dagger A, is 1. So if I want, for example, this, A dagger A will be A dagger. A dagger minus 1. So now I'll stick it here. So if I'll do this, I'll switch these two here. So I'll use this identity. So I have here A dagger minus 1, A is A here, minus half what I had here, A dagger A, and now I have A dagger A dagger A. So all what's left is what?
Minus
A. So all out of all this term, I get minus I omega A, and this would be K1 A and if I do the same thing here, it would be plus K2 A also. So I can write it like that. It's minus I omega minus K1 plus K2, everything times A. And this is A dot. If we brought it from there here. So what does it mean? This I can solve. Linear differential equation that expectation value of A at times t is expectation value of A times 0 times e to the power of what's written. This will be here. Minus I have an oscillatory term, minus k1 plus k2. Everything times t. So how to interpret this? A expectation value of A is my coherence in the harmonic oscillator. So if I see what happened to this, try to interpret the physics that happened in the Lindblad equation of this form. The coherence is oscillating as it should with frequency omega, and it's decaying at a rate which is a k1 minus k2. This is what we get out of this equation. Okay, so we already see that some physics is here. Coherence, if you're coupled to the bath, decays at a certain rate. So we should be sure that this rate is positive, that we don't grow coherence, we kill the coherence. And it's oscillating. Until now, this is good. Okay, so we learned from one solution. What's the next step? We'll do the same thing for the operator, the number operator, d dt of A dagger A. And again, we'll stick it into Lindblad form. So this commutes with this, so we get nothing from this term. So we'll get K1, and I'll write it here, A dagger, and here we'll have A is A dagger A minus half A dagger A plus A dagger A, and the other term. Okay, so now what I see, in order to solve this, I have to switch these two. So then I'll get A dagger A, and again A dagger A. So if I'll switch these two in the middle, I'll get this term here. And I'll have something that's, after I do the switch, I'll have, what I'll have left is basically A dagger A. Okay, here I made a mistake. Nobody caught me. From this.
Also K.
So here the factor of two. So if you do this, I'll get, as a result, that this is minus k1 plus k2, which I didn't do, but you can do it yourself, times A dagger E. Which means, I write a dn, the number operator dt, decays with this rate, so let's put here a 2. So this will become the same rate times n. But I forgot something. I won't get it here. Get it from this term, I'll get it from K2. Times the identity. Okay, so this is an inhomogeneous linear differential equation, which means that you could write it. Okay, I'll erase Lindblad, we saw it enough. I'll go to the top. What happens to this equation when we take the time to infinity? This is an important exercise to do always. So we say dn dt at infinity, what happens? it reaches equilibrium. So this is zero. So we can write immediately out of there that n infinity minus k to the identity is equal to zero. So we could write that n infinity or n equilibrium is k2 divided by, here this is a minus, this is a plus, it doesn't, which is, I can write it k2 divided by k1 minus k2, and I can write it as 1 divided by k1 divided by k2 minus 1. And now I can identify this as k1 to be k1 to be the rate going down, k2, this is k2 is a rate going up. So this becomes 1 divided by e to the power of h bar omega divided by kt minus 1, which is the known expression for the number operator in the harmonic oscillator. I only used one assumption, that the ratio between k up and k down is Boltzmann. That's all I did. I assumed that the bath induces thermal equilibrium by imposing a ratio between these two rates, these k1 and k2, which I guessed them from Lindblad. And I get the result that we know from statistical mechanics, that the number operator, its equilibrium value is this. Okay, then we can go back to this equation. If we know the equilibrium value, we can write an equation directly for the delta n, which is n minus n equilibrium, and delta n is a function of t, is delta n times 0 times e to the power of gamma t. So the change of the number operator from equilibrium, the distance, decays exponentially with this rate. This is what we get here, is the rate of decay. So this is one result that has been known from other parts of physics, that when you reach equilibrium, you could say that's linear response, but this is linear response that's correct, not even far from equilibrium always, because it's a linear system. So you would expect that the linear system, linear response works always. So this is what we get. And also an interesting result, that the rate of decay of coherence is half the rate of the decay of the number operator. So this is what's called the relation between T1 and T2. So this goes back to Bloch, and we say T1 is a rate of decay of energy, in this case the number operator, and so the question is, what's the relation between the decay of energy and the decay of coherence? So for the harmonic oscillator, we get that for pure relaxation to the bath, we get this factor of 2. So the rate of decay of coherence is half the rate of the decay of energy. Now, in many cases, this is not the case. When you measure, usually coherence is lost much faster than the energy. What it means is that our equation is lacking something. And what it's lacking, if we want to complete this to a physical picture, we can add a term that we call pure defacing, which only influences the coherence, but doesn't influence the energy. So this Bloch, Felix Bloch invented this already for NMR, but we immediately can adopt it to here. We want it to be more physical. Usually coherence is lost faster than you lose it in energy. So in this case, coherence is lost at half the rate that the energy is decaying. So we can add a term to Lindblad equation. Since it's a linear equation, we can always add a term. We'll add a term to Lindblad that only influences the coherence. How can we do that? I erased Lindblad, but I'll do that for you here. So, here, our LA was, as we said, have a Hamiltonian term. And I have your Lindblad terms. I have, where the diagram? Here. This is A. So we had this term K1, we had a term K2, and I want to add a term that doesn't change the energy or the number of it. So how do I do that? I can choose it from a Gaussian semigroup term. If I choose a term that, so we can say V1 was A, V2 was A dagger, and I'll choose V3 to be Hermitian, A dagger A. So if I choose V3 to be A dagger A, since it's Hermitian, we know it will generate a double commutator. So the Lindblad term that we'll get is associated to this would be A dagger A, A dagger A, and here we'll have our A, and minus with some coefficient before. Okay, so since this is Hermitian, this is the Lindblad form that we'll get, and now we can check it. So if our big operator A is A dagger A, this commutes. It doesn't influence the number operator because it commutes with here, so it doesn't. But if I'll put here A, so let's see what happens. If I put here A, I'll get A dagger A with A gives me back A with minus. And I'll have minus A, but I have this commutator again. Again, it will give me A minus. So if I'll write this for A, I'll get minus gamma A dagger A, A dagger A, A. This will be minus gamma A. So what did I get? Pure exponential decay only for the coherence. So a term like that, which is a double commutator with a Hamiltonian, is called pure defacing. It doesn't change the energy, but it changes anything that doesn't commute with the energy. So this is an important term too. It's part of our toolkit in quantum.